Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of 2022 on the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 4 in private. Are members content? Thank you. So our next item of business is a continuation of our town centre and retail inquiry. The broad theme for today is e-commerce and opportunities for Scottish businesses. The committee will hear evidence from two panels, and I welcome the first panel, which is Gillian Crawford, who is Managing Director for Lily Blanche, Caroline Currie, Chief Executive Women's Enterprise Scotland, Stuart McKinnon, Head of Communications and Public Affairs at the Federation of Small Businesses Scotland, and Peter Moforth, Chief Executive of Indes. So thank you all for coming this morning. As always, can ask members and witnesses to keep their questions and answers as concise as possible. And you may not be asked to respond to every question, but you will get an opportunity to speak during the course of this morning. Could I maybe first ask the first question, and I probably will give you all an opportunity to have a brief go at this one. During the evidence that we've heard so far, there is always a discussion around the role of e-commerce. And you know, some will contend that it's an undue threat to high streets. It's one of the contributing factors to a demise in high street. Everybody shops online now. Nobody goes down to their high streets. Is that how you see e-commerce in the future? What do you think it's relevant? Do you think it's a threat to the high street, or does it have something positive to bring to the high street? I'll maybe bring in Gillian first, and then I will come to the other panellists.
Absolutely not. I think it's a myth that that is the case. I think you can look at the statistics and see that is very much not the case. So UK online retail sales grew to 119 billion in 2021 and accounted for just under 30%, 28.9% of all retail sales. The most retail sales still take place on the high street. And I think if you want to look at, I mean, it's clear that e-commerce is a growing market, but it's also clear that the kind of real sweet spot is that omni-channel experience. So if you've got a bricks and mortar shop, you are going to do much better with e-commerce than if you haven't. It's a really dangerous fallacy to suggest that it's e-commerce versus the high street, because it so isn't. And I think, you know, one statistic that I'd like to just point out to sort of show you how future-proof this idea of bricks and clicks is, and how the way we shop is changing, but it's not going from one thing to another. It's coming into a much more omni-channel mixed way of shopping, is that we just had the list for 2021 for America, and traditional retailers with bricks and mortar stores dominated the top of the top 10 US e-commerce websites, with the biggest gains in Google in 2021. So there was no pure play e-commerce site in the top 10 in terms of Google e-commerce gains, and that is because of their bricks and mortar stores. So even if you're a small business and you have bricks and mortar and e-commerce working together, that is absolutely the best way to do commerce. And I think, you know, I think the idea that it's e-commerce versus the high street is something that we really need to just put aside right at the very beginning, because it's just not true.
Thank you, Gillian. Stuart, and then I'll come to Peter.
Thanks a lot. I would initially point out that the problems that Scottish high streets and town centres face predate the rise of e-commerce. You know, over the last 30, 40 years, we've seen supermarkets, we've seen out-of-town retail, we've seen a shift in how we work and live, and all of that's had an impact on our town centres and our high streets. One of the things I would highlight, one of the few silver linings out of the pandemic, is we've seen a big spike in the number of businesses and small businesses improving their digital capabilities. Survey work that we did suggests that a fifth of Scottish businesses said that the COVID crisis led to them adopting new digital technologies, with one in seven businesses saying that the pandemic led to them selling online for the first time. So from our point of view, there's a real opportunity to try and cement those gains in the digital capabilities of small businesses by providing smaller firms with the right sort of support to really professionalise their offer. We've seen some of that through the Digital Boost Co-Investment Grant, which we think is an excellent initiative, and we would like to see that retained. But there's further work to do, in our view, to use that help that's on offer as bait, if you like, for smaller firms to really build their digital capacity, both in an e-commerce sense, but also to really improve their business function overall.
Mm-hmm. Before I come to Peter, can I just follow up with Stuart? Some of the local businesses that we had at the round table and ones in within my own region have spoken to me recently about, during the pandemic, they did start to sell online and their online sales were really positive and it was a growth part of their business. They're really seeing they're describing it as quite a significant dip in online sales. Now, that could be the cost of living crisis. They think that's going to be a factor. And so, but it could just, they're trying to understand why that is. And they're speaking to me about, they're small businesses, so when they're making investment decisions, they seem to be trying to decide, do I invest in the online offer and make that, more attractive, or do I focus on my local market, which has been the market prior to the pandemic? What kind of advice as an organisation? Is that a common story that you're hearing from small businesses, and what advice would you give them?
There is a tension there about trying to ride both horses, running a shop and running an e-commerce business. And as an organisation, FSB offers a whole stack of support for our members looking to expand their e-commerce offer and improve their retail offer. From our point of view, and I think that situation you've described, where perhaps it was the same customers that were using the businesses online that are now visiting them in person, is something that we can all understand. However, I think that if we can get the support right for small businesses, it is possible for many of them to have complementary e-commerce and retail offers.
Okay, thank you. Peter, would you like to come in?
Thank you very much, convener. This whole thing is being put forward almost as a combative problem between, on the one hand, e-commerce using different techniques, different skills, different approaches to trade, and traditional businesses. And this really is a complete misnomer. It used to be the case that a business's shop window was a large sheet of glass. These days, companies... High Street retailer's shop window is very often this. People come into town, they've already done their research. They know what products, so they just want to work out where they can find them. I mean, we've worked with big, highly successful Scottish companies like Chisholm Hunter, whose businesses have never been stronger and fitter, because all of their products that they have in store are communicated through Google so that people can find them. Even if you're a traditional retailer, and my suspicion is that probably 98% of Scottish retailers do not use Google Merchant Center. They do not upload their inventories, which are free systems to use, so that if anybody is looking to purchase something, they can just look in Google Images, Google Maps, or whatever, and there the products are. These are free services. They're easily available, and instead of it being two camps, e-commerce and high street retail, there's a complete spectrum of technology. These things are easy to use. The elephant in the room is skills, because people just don't know what they don't know, and nobody is providing the training to help people make the best of trade in the modern world.
Thank you, Peter. Good morning, Caroline. Do you want to come in?
Yeah, thanks. I'd just like to pick up on some of those points that were made. In terms of training, what Peter said, as an organisation, we were funded by the Scottish Technology Ecosystem, and we have just delivered, we've just finished delivering a series of 17 different events. And they were taster sessions to see how women would engage with technology. And we set out from the outset to support women to engage with e-commerce, because women are the majority of employees in that sector, as I'm sure you will be aware. And also it is a sector where women set up a lot of businesses. And what I can tell you is I've just totted up the numbers last night. So we had a total of 433 businesses engaging across those different events. We held peer learning groups. They were extremely well attended across all the different subjects that we trialled, but especially well attended in the e-commerce peer learning groups. We had two e-commerce peer learning groups, other peer learning groups were on subjects like cyber security, for example. We ran basic getting to grips with technology webinars. We had 5 of those, again, on a range of subjects. Again, we decided we would hold 2 events on e-commerce. And again, those 2 events were extremely well attended. We held 3 masterclasses. They were on artificial intelligence, data analytics, and a masterclass on e-commerce, which was very well attended. And what we can say from that is, when you make training available to a community that wishes to engage, the engagement is absolutely there. So, you know, we only had a period of about 2 months in which to deliver these events. So they were not particularly, you know, well advertised in terms of the length of time for businesses to have awareness of them. They were free. They went out to our community of women-owned businesses. And I think by any standards, a total of 433 engagements across that reach is pretty phenomenal and evidences the desire of businesses to engage with technology. And our research over the years has told us that access to digital resources is one of the areas where women struggle persistently. So when you make it available, they will engage. On the point about the dip in online sales that has cropped up in our peer learning events, and certainly our community are seeing that, you know, across the board as a bit of a trend. We discussed that, and, you know, I think, again, skills, data analytics. Pete has already touched on the range of tools that are free through Google. It is making people aware of those resources and giving businesses the skills with which to engage. There is a plethora of free resources there, but it is curating that learning with different communities that is really, really important. For us, we know from our experience that creating a safe environment where women-owned businesses can come to learn and to engage has an impact and has an uptake. And the other point that I do want to touch on was Stuart mentioned the Digital Boost Grant. We are not quite as convinced that is a robust tool for businesses to engage. There are some quite serious structural inequalities in the framework that is used with Digital Boost. For example, it's a graduated system. You have to be a VAT registered business in order to access the higher grants. Yet consistently, our community are telling us they cannot access digital resources. These are not VAT registered businesses. These are small businesses that could be regenerating local high streets or in the retail sector, and they are unable to access the higher amounts of investment. You know, the lower amount in Digital Boost is £5,000. That is not going to transform your e-commerce capability or help you with your digital ambitions. So we're really missing a serious trick there in terms of the opportunities to engage more businesses with digital and businesses that could really become the backbone of local communities. Women-owned businesses are only 20% at best of the business base currently. Only 14%, that's dipped down from 21% of employer-owned businesses. So we have a phenomenal opportunity to engage these businesses with a digital strategy and a strategy of regenerating our high streets.
Okay, thank you, Carolyn. I might bring in Michelle Thompson, who's interested in some of the issues that you've raised, and then I'll come to Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you. Caroline, I wanted to just explore a situation with yourself in particular concerning women in enterprise. We've read a lot of context and background of how you support and develop town centres, and it's a highly complex area, which I appreciate. But I wonder to what extent you had given consideration of how well women-led businesses are reflected in what you've seen with town centre development. So, for example, we know that cars often act as, you know, our cities have been designed around cars. Towns, in some respects, have inherited that as well. But I haven't heard very much, or indeed been able to read very much about, you know, putting women's businesses, or indeed general diversity themes, at the heart of town centre development. Thank you.
Okay, well, it is utterly lacking in the current strategy. there is reference to the fact that women are, you know, 60% of employees. They're also majority of small businesses that set up in the retail sector. And currently, you know, the strategy talks about inclusion, rightly so, but does not speak about the actual groups that, that are intended to be included. You know, women are a significant demographic. They're the majority of the population at 51% in Scotland. And if we do want to have successful and vibrant town centres, we need a distinct strategy to engage women, full stop, but certainly to engage women-owned businesses. So, you know, what could be considered are gender-specific initiatives. You know, we see a women's business centre model as a model by which you can successfully engage and revitalise business ownership for women. It's highly successful in countries that have the leading percentages of women-owned businesses, so in Canada and in the United States. So, for example, in the United States, women-owned businesses have seen phenomenal growth on the back of this model. They are now 40%, so that is double at best. You know, I say at best we are 20%. That's probably slightly optimistic. But, you know, in the United States, 40% of women's business ownership, women-owned businesses are 40% of the business base. So that is a model that is very successful economically. It's creating jobs. We already know women contribute 8.8 billion into the economy. And it's important to say in context, that is more than each of the designated growth sectors. So at 8.8 billion, women's contribution is more than food and drink. It is more than creative industries. You know, it is more than sustainable tourism. We need a dedicated strategy in order to unlock the full potential. We could do with another 8.8 billion in our economy. And women have also created 230,000 jobs. Now that is 13% of private sector employment. So a dedicated strategy to help women start up businesses, locating women's business centres in town centres, to me, makes good economic sense, and we would urge the committee to seriously consider those strategies to engage women and to boost the economy and to create those new jobs that our communities really need.
Okay, I can see, Peter, you had raised your finger. You wanted to come in as well.
Yes, there's... on the INDES blog, there's a link to a large study that's just been conducted that suggests that e-commerce by far is the most successful area of digital in terms of gender equality between males and females at all levels. And unlike the gaming industry or cyber or some of these other areas, there are a very large number. Around 50% of business owners are female, e-commerce managers are female, and at all levels within the group there appears to be equality, and that really doesn't apply to other areas. So,
okay, thanks.
Well, just like to make a quick point about enterprise support, where traditionally our enterprise support models have been reluctant to support retailers with the view that the bulk of the business base will take care of itself. And, you know, looking towards this week's local government elections, one of the things in our FSB's manifesto for this election is trying to get the Business Gateway Service to provide dedicated support for minority ethnic and female entrepreneurs, which we think will have a key role in helping us rebuild our business base that's taken a huge hit over the last 2 years. You know, official Scottish Government statistics show that we've got 20,000 fewer businesses in Scotland over a single year of the pandemic, and we need to see renewed action to rebuild the very small businesses that we lost during the pandemic.
And my last wee question before we move on this, I mean, obviously you've spoken about women's enterprise centres at the heart of developing communities, and I can see a very virtual link with getting more women involved in e-commerce and with what we want to try and do, the encouraging STEM as you move down the generations. Just a quick question, are there any other ideas that would really lend a shift to some of the systemic issues we've got around town planning? I mean, most surveyors are men, most traffic planners are men, so on. So just a perhaps a hard question, given that's not your, your specialism, all of you, which I appreciate, but just any other ideas before we move on?
I would definitely...
Sorry to interrupt. I might just bring in Gillian. I'm the only person that can see Gillian's request to come in as I'm sitting, and I think she was interested in the first question you asked, Michelle, as well as...
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to follow on from what Harry and Pete were saying there. I'm also chair of the British Association of Women Entrepreneurs in Scotland, and I'm an ambassador for Women's Enterprise Scotland. And in that capacity, I'm very interested in bridging the gender enterprise gap. And I think e-commerce is in, I've written a paper on this, e-commerce is in particularly good position. As Pete pointed out, the barriers to entry are not capital-based as they are in things like fintech or other kinds of technological businesses. They're really skills-based and they're knowledge-based. And I think we've seen that the key reasons that women find it difficult to set up and scale up businesses can all be overcome by using e-commerce as a model, because it's such a productive model and it's such a flexible model. And I've proved this myself in my own business, in the way that I started up and brought my e-commerce business. It was a traditional business to start with, but we know that women have lower levels of capitalization, they have a lack of access to finance, there's a propensity for women-owned businesses to be run from home, there are issues around childcare and flexible working, there are lower levels of full-time employees in women's businesses, and there's a concentration of women's businesses in the traditionally female sectors. And all of these things really play into e-commerce as a model, because e-commerce is a perfect model for moving from a job part-time or full-time into business ownership. You can do it part-time, you can do it at the kitchen table, you can do it with the kids around your ankles, you can do it while you're looking after your elderly parents. You know, it's so flexible, you can do it, 5 to 9, and you can build it slowly, and you don't even need your own website. You can do all of this on platforms. I mean, e-commerce is such a flexible model that really all it needs is some kind of basic connectivity. And that's why it's so good for rural businesses, for businesses for people with disabilities or special needs. There's all sorts of areas where people are left out of the mainstream of business ownership, where e-commerce can really play a very vital role. And I know this because I've done it, and I've seen lots of other people do it, men and women and people in rural communities. And the big problem is that it's this access to knowledge and access to skills and knowing where to go to get the information that's lacking. And we talk about e-commerce and its place in the high street, and that is very important. You know, this is just such a golden opportunity for Scotland just now that if we don't take it, we'd be quite mad. E-commerce is growing at a rate of knots. It is difficult just now. E-commerce sales have dropped off a cliff with the pandemic opening up and people spending now on experiences and travel. So e-commerce businesses are finding it very, very tough just now. But we will ride through that storm with, using technology to its best abilities. But the other thing is, if we don't use e-commerce now, we will not be able to future-proof the Scottish economy. I mean, if for example, the money that is spent in high streets just now circulates within the local economy, you buy things in the high street, that money doesn't go anywhere. Now, Scots are just as likely to buy online as anyone else in the UK, but they're much less likely to sell online. We don't even know how many e-commerce businesses there are. We don't collect statistics. We don't know who the biggest are. But what we do know is that if we don't have a thriving e-commerce sector here, that money will just flow into the hubs in Manchester and London, where they are really building fantastic e-commerce businesses around airports and around transport links down there. And we've heard the Hut Group say that it was going to employ 10,000 e-commerce skilled people. I mean, these people are hard to find and they're hard to retain in Scotland. If we don't get into the skills business now, if we do go independent, for example, that money will just flow out of the Scottish economy, and there's no way of keeping it here because e-commerce doesn't respect borders. And I think that's something that really worries me as a business person, that we have this fantastic opportunity, but if we don't take it, we have potential real detriment to the Scottish economy as I see it.
Thank you for that, Gillian. Just going back to before we move on, obviously e-commerce and enablers and skills and so on is going to be a big topic, which other people, I suspect, will come in. But just to finish off this piece around women-led businesses, my second question was, in addition to those areas that we've already highlighted, given that this is quite a generic town centres inquiry, any other ideas about what we need to do to put women-led businesses at the heart of town centre redevelopment, which I appreciate is a hard question to ask you guys, given that's not your specialism, but just any other ideas before we can move on?
Yeah, I would like to say absolutely the design of town centres is crucial to this. And I would argue that town centres are in part declining simply because they have failed to respond to women's needs as well as other retail outlets have. So important points for women are, you know, it's safety. Women need to feel safe when they are going into town centres, and issues like inadequate signage, for example, poor toilet facilities, poor transport connections, all combine to make women feel unsafe. And in fact, I was looking just to see what research had been done recently. And what I can tell you is the UK didn't make the top 10 of the safest countries in the world for women. So we're not on the top 10. And looking at research that has been done in terms of women's perceptions of town centres, then Cleveland Police did a study in the wake of the Sarah Everard murder and the Safer Streets campaign. And what the police in Cleveland found from their survey is a whopping 80%, over 80% of women felt unsafe in Teesside. And that was in 2021. So that is right here in our doorstep in the UK. And issues that were being cited were, you know, poor lighting, poor parks, poorly lit areas. Women felt unsafe exercising in those areas. And they felt unsafe because of the presence of substance misusers, beggars and men staring at them were some of the key reasons that were given. You know, in this day and age, I think it's pretty shocking that we have women reporting over 80% of them feel unsafe in those areas. You know, what is needed is a clear strategy that harnesses women, that puts women at the heart of these urban areas regeneration, because we have a real opportunity to create towns and centres, to redevelop them in partnership with other agencies, businesses coming together, but also other agencies like housing and also potentially tourism, to make these destinations of choice. Destinations of choice for everybody in our population, especially destinations of choice for women and families. And significant rework needs to be done to the design of our city centres and our urban areas in order to engage women, particularly now as we come out of COVID and we come out of the pandemic.
Thank you. Carolyn, some of the issues you've raised we will be discussing at a future meeting. I'm now going to come to Gordon MacDonald, followed by Colin Beattie. Can I ask witnesses to be concise in their replies, and we'll try and get through as much business as possible this morning. Gordon.
Okay, thanks very much. During the pandemic, online retail sales reached a share of sales high of 37% in February 21. And I was just wondering, Peter, if you were able to highlight whether that growth in retail sales, whether there was some sectors benefited more than others, and whether it was large retailers that benefited or small retailers or a mix?
It was all kinds of businesses gained, and the drop that we've seen over the last 6 months has simply been the mirror reflection of the significant increase that took place at the start of the pandemic. if you take out the blip while everybody was stuck at home, it's just business as normal. It's just continued in the same sort of directional trend, and we're sort of on track for one third of retail to become mediated by online. I just wanted to pick up on some things that Carolyn said. I was on Sucky Hall Street a week ago. I just hung my head. I was with my wife. We just felt uncomfortable, nervous. I've never seen Sucky Hall Street look so dismal and so bad. It's something, you know, there needs to be a serious wake-up call. I couldn't believe how grubby, dirty, uncomfortable it was. And I can fully understand why a lot of people wouldn't want to go shopping there, given that it is inevitable that there will be a reduced number of high street shops. We need to decide that, so that you don't have every other shop is empty, we need to consolidate shopping areas so that you've got, if someone's going to an area, you don't want to see boarded up windows. You want to make sure that all of those shops are full and vibrant, and very often the reason that people are there is because they found their products through searching online, which is the modern shop window to high street retail. But they're just not doing it.
You said that we're on track to hit a third of online sales being online. Currently, the ONS figures that came out has it down at 25% from the 37% high.
Yeah.
When do you see that growth hitting 33%?
Well, remember, before the pandemic hit, it was 19.
Yeah.
So it's just business as normal. There's no great shift. There's people are going to continue to make use of online mechanisms for sourcing products and for trading. I mean, the sad fact and the big elephant in the room here is that Scotland is seriously underperforming in e-commerce. We're the worst part of the UK for online trade, and we have 8% of the population and 1.9% of the e-commerce jobs. I mean, And the key reason why I think Scotland has underperformed is that at all levels, we've not provided the right kind of skills training. This is at business ownership, at investment, at e-commerce manager, at specialist skills, and at junior skills. One of the key reasons why that skill set has been not sufficient is because it's not been provided by hands-on practitioners. It's been provided within the agencies. That's a personal view.
You touched on the role of the agencies. Skills Development Scotland's got a national transition training fund that's supposed to help. They announced that, I think, in November. It'll help up to 20,000 people with digital technology. Will that start to address the issue you've highlighted?
They have just launched an e-commerce training scheme that was where the agenda for the course was put together by the colleges, and it was aimed at unemployed people. And across all three colleges, they got precisely zero people applying to go on the course, which is the exact opposite of what Carolyn found when you start engaging with hands-on practitioners who know and understand the subject. There has to be an engagement by the agencies with the industrial sector and the business sector that actually provide these competences and want to see them more broadly used within Scotland. It's failed so far.
And Stuart, how do we encourage, Peter highlighted 98% of companies don't engage online. He talked about Chisholm Hunter. I found another example of Findra Clothing that's had 40% year-on-year growth and has opened another shop in Edinburgh. How do we get that message across to small businesses, private businesses, that the way forward is online?
I think that the latest Scottish Government digital economy survey revealed 35% of Scottish businesses were trading online. And I would highlight the figures that I mentioned earlier about the shift that we saw during the pandemic and the need to cement those gains. I think that I would highlight again, I know that Carrie highlight some issues with the Digital Boost Development Grant. I would say that's an argument for further expanding the programme. I know that there's £100 million has been committed to that programme already. I think that co-investment grant model, there's a really good opportunity to use that as a mechanism to get more businesses engaged with the enterprise support that's on offer. Just reflecting on what Pete was saying, again, the same Scottish Government survey reveals only a fifth of Scottish businesses believe that they've got all the digital skills that they need. And there's what we need to do to solve that problem is to try and better connect Scotland's business community with our educational providers, whether that's colleges, universities, or private providers as well. And I think to a certain extent that's a question of incentives and getting those incentives right. But there's another factor here, which I think is just the marketing and trying to make sure that the courses, the training that's on offer from our education system really meets the needs of business owners and especially small business owners that might have different needs to larger companies who can, for instance, allow staff to be off for longer periods of time.
So can I just make a point of clarification, please? That when I said 98%, I'm saying 98% of small high street retailers do not use these free and simple tools that would allow them to upload their inventory, their product catalogues to find. You don't need to have an e-commerce platform. Google provides you free and easy use, and it's just nobody knows about it and nobody teaches it, and the skills are not taught by anybody.
Thanks for that clarification. Caroline, have you got anything to add? I mean, how do we encourage people to take up this opportunity?
Yeah, I just really want to briefly say I'm a chartered banker, so I like nothing better than leveraging resources as much as you possibly can. And to me, that's actually what we're failing to do. We are not connecting up well between the agencies and between the communities of interest. So their SDS, there's a great example of an initiative that, you know, could have been super and hasn't worked. What we need to be better at doing is connecting up this pipeline of resources that we've got, because some of these resources are very good. You know, there's some basic free training, for example, through Business Gateway, that is helpful. We need to connect up that pipeline with the gaps in that training and with the communities where these businesses are. So, you know, Pete's talked about the engagement with expert practitioners. We see that. We see women will go. They will go to where there is low cost or free training. Women do not have resources to spend on this to get started. So they will go to those communities, those trusted places. They will congregate there, and you can target and deliver through harnessing those communities. What we tend to see is these initiatives are delivered in silos. They do not connect up with communities like ourselves. I mean, I hope the example of the STAIR grant evidences beyond any doubt that the appetite is there. What we are not doing is curating the engagement. So, you know, we need to get better at curating the agency's engagement with the communities where the businesses are, and just connecting up that pipeline. It isn't actually that difficult to do. And then we could see more results like the pilot schemes we've seen. You know, as an organisation, I've now had 400-odd businesses engaging. I need to find a way to try to keep that going, because we have now created a demand for that. So I am actively looking for partners to come and help me with the community that we've created, and I want to keep curating. That I see could have a huge economic impact here.
Okay. Thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to expand a little bit on what Peter was talking about earlier on in terms of developing digital services. What level of collaboration, if any, is there between Scottish universities and colleges and the retail businesses in developing digital services?
Nothing that I'm aware of.
Nothing at all?
There probably is somewhere, but I'm not aware of it. And I'm pretty well placed to know if there was something going on. I mean, for instance, two years ago, we ran an advanced course for e-commerce managers at Strathclyde Business School. But it was delivered by a company. And that was delivered by Indes, but it was not delivered by the academics. And I think the whole problem here is that if you're looking for e-commerce skills, where you shouldn't start is with the colleges and universities, because anybody who had significant skills in e-commerce would have probably left to to set up an e-commerce business. So the thing is, the practitioners, the people who know what's going on, the people who know where all the trip-up points are, what tools you should be using, what the best practices are, what the cheapest, quickest ways to get your e-commerce business running, are with the hands-on practitioners. And they're largely sidelined because the, you know, the delivery mechanisms sit within the agencies.
Stuart, assuming you agree with Peter's statement there on that there's no collaboration at the moment, is there any way that collaboration could be put in place? What would it look like? And how practical is it to expect practitioners to take time out from their business to train people coming up?
I would sort of gently disagree with Pete in that. I do know that there are several initiatives by colleges and universities in Scotland in relation to digital skills in the rounds, perhaps not the specialist sort of e-commerce type training and education that Pete's describing. There's also other initiatives out there at the moment, like the Help to Grow digital initiative led by the UK government and universities in Scotland. So there are initiatives in the pipeline.
How joined up are they?
I think it would be fair to say that there's a question of scale. If this is an economy-wide problem and the bulk of businesses or the bulk of retailers, shall we say, for the purposes of this inquiry, are going to upskill and reskill both the business owner and their staff, then we're probably going to have to massively increase the amount of the amount of training and support that's on offer. And the question then becomes, how do you reach the business community, and especially the small business community, which at times can be very difficult to reach? And while organisations like WES, like FSB can play a key role, there's also a question about ensuring that, for instance, that the money perhaps provided through the funding councils to universities and colleges is perhaps shaped in such a way to encourage them to provide training and courses which are used by the business communities to try and shape those incentives so that they're providing the help that businesses want.
I guess the impression I got from what you described, various initiatives, that they didn't seem to be terribly joined up. They seemed to be individual initiatives which, you know, have been launched for very good reasons, but if you're looking across the piece at the retail businesses and then what offerings come from the colleges and universities, it doesn't sound terribly strong.
I know that Colleges Scotland, for example, did some work in this area recently, and we're trying to develop a more cohesive and comprehensive report. I can say that I have a global picture of who's doing what. I couldn't say at this time, you know, 50% of colleges, but my impression is that it's really been at the discretion of individual educational providers.
Sorry, Peter, do you want to come back in?
Look, you can't get away from the fact that e-commerce involves technology. When small businesses want to find out how they can increase their sales, how they can get more profit and through their own business, they need to know specific skills such as, how do I set up Google Merchant Center? How do I set up an inventory feed? What type of photographs do I need and what format should they be in? And how do I upload them? And how long will it take? And how much is it going to cost? These are the kind of, you know, technical business questions that small businesses want to know, and none of these initiatives that I've heard about offered within the sort of the colleges and the usual infrastructure for further and higher education provide this kind of information. The only people who have access to all of the details of this lie within the hands-on practitioners, who are always expected to give their time and their effort for free.
Julian, can I maybe bring you in? What's your impression of the level of support for developing digital services?
Well, I was lucky enough to be on the course that Pete was talking about that INDES delivered at Strathclyde, and it was a really useful course. I think one of the most useful things about it was that we were able to create a community of e-commerce people out of it, and that has been a WhatsApp group which has been really helpful. So these were senior e-commerce managers, and we now can share information. I mean, before that, we didn't really know each other existed. And I think there is just the real need to bring a community together in the e-commerce space. There's lots and lots of people who are super willing to give their time for free, it has to be said. And I mean, there's some brilliant e-commerce managers in Scotland. I'm thinking about someone like Jason Stewart at Donald Russell, the Online Future, really brilliant, brilliant e-commerce manager who's champing at the bit to see if he can help, you know, bring other people on. And there isn't a forum for him to do that yet. I mean, I've been lucky because I've been able to work with Carrie and with Pete to do a bit of training. And that's been really very satisfying. But the big issue here, I think, is that it's not static. That's the problem. Things move so quickly in the world of e-commerce and in the fields of e-commerce and within your own business. So, you know, your e-commerce is quite, it's where technology and psychology meet, if you know what I mean. So you have to have a very wide range of skills to do it well. And you have a lot of levers that you can pull. You've got paid traffic, you've got unpaid traffic, you've got SEO, you've got, you know, offline and online PR and all the rest of it. You've got influencers, you've got Instagram, you've got social. And at any time, any one of these can change, or, you know, suddenly the rules change, and or suddenly, you know, the best practice changes, or the way the consumer is buying changes. And you can't wait for 6 months for somebody in a course to tell you that that's what's happened. You need to be on it right then, because if your e-commerce sales start to go, you know, they can go really quickly, and you've got to find a way of, you know, of moving the dial and finding another lever to pull. And so it is quite a kind of complicated business in lots of different ways, just because there are so many elements to it and it's so fast moving and fast changing. And I mean, that is fantastic. I mean, that's just so exciting, because you have the whole world as your potential marketplace. You know, we're selling into America, we're selling on Etsy. You know, people that we could never have reached in any other way are finding our products and loving our products. And, you know, we have a real community. So we're actually selling quite a traditional product in a very cutting edge way, but we're still managing to keep a traditional consumer-customer relationship with our customers, but just using technology. And I think that, you know, that's at the heart of this, is just how fast moving it is and how important having a community of people who are doing the same things, who can tell you, you know, what they're doing, what's worked, what hasn't worked, what they're paying for things. You know, there's a lot of lack of transparency in some of the apps. So you find that, you know, even what you're paying for, transaction fees on processing your payments through, you know, a different merchant provider, all that sort of stuff is absolute gold dust to a small business like us. And we don't have huge resources to spend in this area. But I think, you know, there's so much enthusiasm in Scotland within the community that, you know, there's a real willingness to share, but it's just finding a mechanism to do it and finding a way of keeping that community and bringing more people into that community, some kind of forum going, I think.
Caroline, one last question to you. Sorry.
I might have to make some progress. We are quite pushed for time. Okay. Thank you. Maggie Chapman, followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks very much, Ken. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for being here. Following on, actually, from Colin's questioning around skills and training, looking at it from within retail, within businesses themselves, Peter and Carolyn, you've both talked about the lack of skills within there, but the Digital Economy Business Survey highlighted that only 50% of businesses seem to have any interest in training their own team. How can we shift that? What is it that we need to do with that? And I suppose linked to that is one of the barriers, or one of the things that is slowing things down, a lack of the adequate infrastructure on our high streets. You know, access to the digital infrastructure that businesses and wholesale providers need. Carolyn, I'll come to you first.
Okay, thanks very much. Where to start? I am chair of the board of the Productivity Institute in Scotland. So in terms of the 50% interest and engagement, I'd like to pick up on that, because we just published our green paper at the end of last year. And in fact, digital investment is one of the areas that we are going to look at and analyse, I hope, using actually some of the data that has been created by all the work the government has delivered so far For example, around Digital Boost, we have a huge data set there that can help inform us on best practice and can then help share back that best practice with the community. So important to say that hopefully some information will come that will help to inform and direct future investment, because I think that insight is actually lacking. And 50% is a huge amount, isn't it? The other area that we see as a key issue that relates to this is leadership. You know, leadership is a key interface with digital and skills and actually progressing that. What we hear from a lot of leaders is that the nervousness around engaging with digital, it is a constantly changing environment. So, you know, at what point do you pick up? Where do you intervene? Who can help you to get a lens on your business and tell you with confidence and clarity where you actually need to invest? I think one of the key worrying statistics that I've seen is that around 50% of investment in digital made by businesses is deemed to not have worked. So, you know, that is whopping, isn't it, in terms of economic impact and opportunity missed. So I think we need to get much better insight into what is working so we can help to inform businesses. And I mean, the good news there is we do have mechanisms to reach these businesses and reach these communities. I've talked about the work that we do with WES, but also SCDI run regional productivity clubs. They are out there regionally in local communities working with businesses that are interested in boosting their productivity, and particularly that are interested in developing their digital footprint. And there are some good case studies in there from businesses that have been successful. But there is no doubt about it, there is a phenomenal amount of work to be done. We need to support our leaders to invest in skills, to showcase best practice. You know, I mean, an example from my work at WES, we, for the first time during the pandemic, took on an entry role, a young intern. After 6 months with us, she went off and got her dream job working for Penguin Books in London. We took on a second intern, a young woman who was really interested in policy and policy work. Now, we have just developed a large digital platform, the Women's Business Centre, and we brought Katie, our new intern, in and trained her in that digital work. 6 months on, she's just resigned. She is now off to work for a tech scaler. It is in the top 10 in the Times list of scale-up companies based in London, and she is going in to work in a search engine optimization role after just 6 months of working with us on our digital platform. Imagine what we could do if we were able to replicate that. You know, we are a small business. You know, my budget is referred to by my staff as 20 pence and two Snickers bars, and they're not far wrong. So, you know, if we can manage to do something like this, I feel this is very relatable for other small and micro businesses in terms of a route to bring in and develop young people and to develop skill sets. And the training we've delivered is largely founded on the free tools that are out there that we are shamelessly mining and capitalising on for our digital platform.
Thanks. Peter, do you want to come in?
Just a useful little sort of snippet statistic. The largest study that's been done shows that e-commerce is 17% greener in terms of its footprint than traditional sort of retail. It's just efficient use of journey time. I can see the point you're getting at, Maggie. What can be done to try to improve things? Well, I mean, look, a good starting point would be if politicians and governments could talk about this subject a little bit more. From the industry perspective, I'm biased. We all sort of live in our own little sort of silo and our own sort of bubble. I live in a world that's full of technology and business, and I look at politicians as a group, and I don't see the same, you know, sort of shared space around sort of this total focus around sort of business and technology and that sort of synthesis of the two. So if politicians could just talk about e-commerce a bit more, that might actually help move the dial. So that would be really good. It's so huge. It's, you know, ONS statistics, as mentioned, 680 billion. I mean, it's bigger. It's massive. And yet there isn't an SQA qualification for it in Scotland. The subject's not sort of taught very well. And I think part of it is how do we move the dial? What can you do about it? Well, doing something to promote, you know, the few fantastic businesses and case studies that we have here in Scotland. Because believe you me, there's nothing would give me greater pleasure than to see an army of Scottish businesses going out and really sort of, you know, sort of helping create wealth, create high-paid jobs. There's a focus by the agencies around exporting. Where we need to export to is the rest of the UK to start with, because it's kind of difficult to export, you know, beyond that because of all the sort of other problems that there are. But all the low-hanging fruit is just selling more within the UK, doing more of this. And we need fantastic case studies that can inspire businesses and business owners to actually, you know, get on board this e-commerce train and start doing something about it. And this is a story that's been coming out from business year after year after year, and nothing gets done. And I don't know why. And is it simply because on this side of the room, we're people who have got our heads around and understand technology and business and how the two can be fantastic for creating, you know, advanced first world countries with well-paid jobs and everything? Or are we going to sort of sit, you know, 100-year-old technology just working on the high street in the same old ways that it used to be done?
Thanks. Can I bring Stuart in on this as well, and also the question around infrastructure and what your members are telling you about?
Yeah, absolutely. So I would say my heart absolutely sinks when I read that statistic in the Scottish Government report. You know, I think it's a fairly frightening figure. I think it's actually, I understand that this isn't just a technology problem or a digital problem. You know, the amount that we're doing in terms of upskilling our existing staff isn't good enough. We need to change that culture. I would return to this point that we've got a really good product in the Digital Boost Grant, and there's an opportunity to use through the better integration of our enterprise networks and maybe our skills bodies, that there's an opportunity to say, you're getting this grant, hey, have you thought about training up your staff to, you know, use this new technology that you're getting, and here's their programme of support in the future. Just to make a related point, you know, we've seen the Code Clan model as a success, but that's a very high end product. You know, could we replicate a similar vocational training course, but for a different skill sets? You know, is there an opportunity there to look at that success story and say that worked? Let's do more of that. In relation to digital infrastructure, you know, the official stats show that both broadband and mobile coverage is improving in Scotland. It isn't quite reaching the political ambitions that we would like to see. I would particularly highlight 4G coverage as an ongoing problem. You know, I sit on the Scottish Government's 4G infill programme and as an advisor, but I would say that there's still a huge amount that we need to do there, especially as a consequence, because things like cashless payment technologies are relying on digital decent infrastructure. I would say that there's currently a focus on speed, and reliability is often a much more important factor for many of our members out there. And I would say that at the moment, the telecoms market, the products that are out there, from our perspective, there doesn't seem to be a wide enough diversity of products that are out there in comparison to the wide range of businesses that are out there with different needs.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Colin, sorry, Fiona has talked before by Colin Smith.
Thank you. There's some very interesting insights. Some of them are actually contradictory between yourselves, which I think is also fascinating. I'm not sure Mr. Moth attacking politicians for talking about e-commerce in a committee that's looking at e-commerce is necessary.
And I welcome it. I just want more of it.
Yeah, so. More of it. Okay, that's good to hear that. And I was interested in what Caroline was saying about curating a community of interests. And I'm very sure I had a brief year spell as Economy Secretary during a pandemic and introduced the Digital Boost programme, which again we had to massively increase. I think there's some general issues about the lack of businesses investing in skills that is historic. I think there's historically been a lack of demand for digital from businesses, but
pandemic absolutely accelerated it. So I think there's something about who does this, who does the curating, how do we implement this, and how do we make the step changes that needed? Because our town centres are going to have to be both physical and e-commerce. That's a given, so I'm going to reassure you on that. And Gillian Aycroft, you talked about going to Strathclyde to do a course with Peter. Was that Strathclyde University you were talking about? Sorry, Gillian, you're on mute.
That was the business school, Strathclyde University Business School. And out of that, there was about a group of 20 of us, and Pete is part of that, who still keep up with each other and share knowledge, which has been really helpful.
Okay, so I'm just trying to work out, I know pre-pandemic, the Scottish Tourism Alliance worked trying to stimulate demand, but to try and get tourism businesses to embrace e-commerce. And they did it by almost like a town roadshow, because it was by town. Now we're looking at town centres. So I suppose there are different models of how do we get that curation that Caroline was talking about. You can see it absolutely for women. Is there something physical about towns, whether, you know, with chambers of commerce could curate it as to need, or e-commerce, chambers of commerce, I suppose, chambers of e-commerce. How can we do it to help our town centres and the retailers in our town centres do this? Have you got in your head what that kind of model would look like? And if it's to be, who delivers it? Because the whole point of Digital Boost was to provide grants that you can go and get practitioners to help. So that was the whole point of it, is commercial, etc. Yeah. So what's your, what would be, how do you think that should be delivered? And what is the role then of the agencies, if anything, apart from delivering funding?
Well, I think that's a really good question, and I think your analogy around tourism is a really good one, because, you know, all my experience is that the various tourism bodies have done a brilliant job, I think, about in putting Scotland on the map, and also in connecting their local areas and boosting tourism within the local areas. So I think, you know, that is a very good model, and I think we could look to that. I think, although e-commerce is very much part of the town centre story, and I think, you know, a really good model here is Shoe, you know, the Shoe retailer. So my local Shoe in Stirling has a shop, which is one of the few busy shops in Stirling. But upstairs, they've got three people who are packing e-commerce orders. And I think, you know, there is this real productivity thing that Caroline mentioned as well, you know, where if you are a shop, you have lots of dead time during the day when people are at work and they aren't coming to the shop. If you can have that dual model within your shop where you've got an e-commerce station, it doesn't take up a lot of space. You can pack an e-commerce parcel in the same way as you would pack a parcel for a customer coming in the door. And you've got staff who can be used doing e-commerce work, you know, from a central computer at the same time as serving customers, and during the busy times to serve the customers, during the quiet times to do e-commerce. That's a really productive model, and that's already happening on our high streets with Shoe. I think in terms of who delivers it, it's really got to be the most enthusiastic people. You know, I think that's part of the problem. You know yourself that if you've got really enthusiastic, go-getting, fantastic people delivering something, it will spread like chickenpox in the nursery, and everyone will want a bit of it, and it's fantastic. But if you say it has to be X agency, or, you know, there can be such a variation in knowledge and skills and ability to deliver. So you really need this to be a kind of, I think, almost like a grassroots movement, where you give them the funding and you give them the ability to get together. Because, I mean, I have found a lot of the really beneficial stuff in the peer-to-peer space. And you do need people who know what they're doing. You do need experts who've done it before, and bigger companies who are doing it. But every company is different. There's no one model that's going to fit everything, you know. And I think whenever I'm talking to other e-commerce companies, I have, you know, also very conscious to say this worked for us, and it worked for us in this, you know, in this context and in this time. And, you know, it might be slightly different for you. And everyone is coming with a different platform. Everybody's coming with a different e-commerce experience or digital experience or different sort of barriers to psychological barriers to digital. So, you know, it can't just be a sort of one size fits all. I think it really does have to be quite, you know, quite tailored. It's not a sort of homogenous thing. And I think, you know, if you've got enthusiastic people within your community that you can really get going with this, you've got e-commerce champions in every town centre, in every community. You know, That's the other thing. Digital loves local. I think maybe we haven't mentioned this enough. Google loves local. Google will boost local businesses through Google My Business. Facebook loves local. It's really wanting local. So there's a lot of the big players who are really willing to back local. And I would say, bring in some of the big players. We're very scared of these companies. But, you know, we engage with, you know, the heads of, you know, senior people in Google, senior people in BigCommerce. And we get, you know, these people are willing, they really want to try and boost e-commerce in Scotland, but they don't have a conduit for that. And I would say it would be great if Scottish Enterprise or whoever is, you know, at least has access to these senior people in the UK, in these big companies that really have a lot of input into e-commerce, like Google, like Facebook, like, you know, and that would be a conduit to start with that we could, you know, we then have a route and a way of getting some of the big players involved. I think you need it grassroots. You need it coming from both ends. You know, you need the Scottish Government and the agencies that work for the Scottish Government to facilitate that, I think, whether that is not necessarily in money. And I was a recipient of the Digital Boost, and I'd like to say thank you very much. It was a great thing for my business, and you know, it wasn't perfect, but it was one of the best grants that were out there. And most grants I would just not look at because the amount of time and effort and the conditions of the grant means that it's not really going to be beneficial to us. But Digital Boost was really good for us, and it made a massive difference at the time that we got it.
And I'm kind of conscious of time. Carolyn, I think the VAT registration for Digital Boost was to stop massive fraud that we've seen for pandemic funds in other places. So that does need looked at. And there is something about what Stuart was saying about how do we develop it into a better product. So that curation, women obviously are, you know, 52% of the population in terms of underrepresenting the business, but Scotland wide. But listening to what Gillian was saying there about perhaps we need to localise it more. That some of the packages are there, they're free, it's not, and we want the practitioners. So who does the curation and how do we do it in the platform?
Yeah, so it's a blended initiative, you know, and where we're able to do that, it really works well. And in its simplest form, it is harnessing what each organisation does well and curating that together in a space. So, you know, I've talked about women's business centres. A similar analogy could be an e-commerce space. You know, it could be a space to bring people in that different communities could use. You know, sometimes a one-size-fits-all works for some people. For others, it doesn't. And thinking about the learnings we've had from the events that we curated, some businesses really welcomed the kind of idiot's guide to starting it up, really demystifying it. It is a complex area. It is highly complex and detailed, and that is really off-putting for people. If you're sitting in an environment where you think people understand these different terminologies and the vast array of Google dashboards that you can tap into. So if you are able to curate that with different communities, I'm one community, I would argue absolutely a space where women can come. We can curate that with the businesses that we have a reach to, but we can then help that community to develop and grow. And as Gillian says, as communities develop and grow, they build a much better sense of what they need and what they want. Whereas at the start, they don't necessarily have that confidence. But if you can bring like-minded people together that have the same needs, it's like any new product development, isn't it? The better you target their needs, the more impactful you're going to get for a return. So that's what I would advocate is worth trying. And, you know, trying to bring together that pipeline model of support. You know, the agencies have good contacts with generally larger and scale-up businesses. They can help curate these businesses, bring them together in a forum. I can help curate women-owned businesses, often micro-businesses, but not necessarily in the world of e-commerce. There are businesses out there with significant turnovers that we are not tapping into, that nobody knows exists, that are not hitched up, arguably, to some of our scale-up agencies and resources that are out there. So this is a bit of a two-way path where we could really better leverage all our respective resources in creating this collaborative model that would really boost e-commerce, but boost our national productivity. And the only other thing I want to say is that There are sectors out there that are growing massively that women are represented in and that are not supported, and e-commerce could be the route to supporting women in those sectors. So health, beauty, well-being, massive multi-billion pound sectors. You know, we have huge opportunities and we could use e-commerce to start to tap into that, because our national infrastructure doesn't help with that. As I think Pete originally said, you know, if you turn up in retail, then you're not going to be welcomed with open arms and a plethora of resources, sadly, with the way that our economic development works at the moment. But here's a route where we could curate it better.
So I'm going to be conscious the convener might cut us off, but I think Pete is very just, rich.
Just really quick points. One way, I've so sort of agree with everything sort of Carolyn said here. And I mean, one vehicle for this kind of work, small e-commerce business clubs. I mean, we've got a very successful one in central belt of Scotland. We just need more people come. But we need to maybe engage with some of the agencies that are connected to support mechanisms to try and encourage people to come along, because none of these clubs are ever advertised on any of the agency sites because we're not funded by them, so they don't advertise them, and they could easily. That's the first one. The second one is, we've talked about all these different, what is the best way to provide skills training? Well, rather than force feed, you know, through a college or a university, a course, why can't just like the digital boost grant, why can't you offer training vouchers to companies and let the market vote with its feet? Because if you have good inspirational leaders who have got, you know, just like products bubble to the top on sort of e-commerce sites, because they get great feedback, people really like them. So if only the skills training could be moved to being a voucher based, then, as you know, Gillian's point, people will go to a local supplier who's relevant to them. Why on earth can't we do this?
Okay, Stuart, who and how?
Well, we have seen some of this through BIDS in Scotland. And, you know, BIDS had a key role during the pandemic as well, often organising, like, food deliveries locally to vulnerable customers. And I thought that was a really good initiative that could be built upon. I think the key thing here is, no matter who your initial contact is with, that shouldn't mean that you're not, they don't lead you to other agencies and other bits of support in the public and private ecosystem. I would just like to make a general point about town centres and high streets and independent businesses. The last few years, I've seen independent businesses do a lot of the heavy lifting on our high streets and in our town centres, but they can't do it on their own. And I know e-commerce might seem to be part of the solution for a long-term future for local shops, but also we need to see big business and the public sector play a bigger role in the centres of our local places. We need to see more local facilities in our town centres, whether that's council run or through the blue light services or through parts of the NHS. We need to see organisations like the banks can reconsider getting back into the centre of our local places. We talked about Sockhill Street, but up and down Scotland, there are sort of ugly gap sites, and we need to make them more suitable for a wider range of public and private bodies.
Okay, better.
Thank you. I'll now come to Alexander Burnett, who's on the online platform.
Thank you, convener. I know we're pushed for time, so maybe I'll just direct my question to Stuart, since you stood across. You represent both online and bricks and mortar businesses. In previous sessions, we've heard about an online or digital sales tax has been mooted. I just wonder what your views are on this, and if you were in favour of it. Did you have any idea of what level it might be set at, and any issues and things that might arise from it?
Yeah, I'm aware that the UK government's consulting on an online sales tax right at this moment, and it's fair to say that we're pretty anxious about that. Principally, you know, we heard earlier, a third of Scottish businesses now sell some sort of good and service online. One in seven Scottish businesses started selling online for the first time during the pandemic. We would hate to see businesses which diversified during the last 2 years having to, being hammered by a new online sales tax. We would accept that there's real anxieties about, some big online giants, but our concern is that the damage an online sales tax would do would outweigh any benefit that local traditional operators or businesses trading both online and on bricks and mortars would receive. I think the UK government proposals are in relation to business rates, but the amount that is suggested that it will raise is unlikely to make a significant dent in the business rates income. So broadly, you know, we don't yet know what direction either the UK government will go, or I believe the Scottish government has a commitment to look at an online sales tax too. But at present, you know, we're more nervous that it would harm more of our members than do more good to the to do a net level of good to the Scottish economy.
Thank you. I'm sure it'll be a subject will be revisited in the future. No further questions, Camina. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, I think it was the language I've heard is a level playing field. Is that has thing? I suppose, as you identify, there's the big giants who are online retailers who have been seen as drawing business away from high streets and bricks and mortars. Are we in a more mixed, is it the wrong time to introduce it? Are we in a more mixed phase of retail where we're trying to encourage those who are on high streets to use more online sales? Or is there a role for people who are just online sales groups only that should they should get taxed? They should have an equivalent feed into the in terms of taxes as what bricks and mortar businesses do?
I would start off, if you're going to pursue an online sales tax, I would say that there's a fairly strong argument for a small business exemption. And then even then, there are questions about what sorts of transactions would be covered by the tax, whether B2B transactions, for example, would be included. And there's a question, when we saw the digital services tax introduced, we saw a lot of the online giants, despite it being targeted towards the biggest guys, pass it on to their smaller customers. So there's a question about who pays, even if it is a tax that's targeted towards the biggest operators. I would say, if we're talking about levelling the playing field, that there's a strong case for rejecting new out-of-town developments at this stage, given that we are seeing that pie of in-person bricks and mortar shopping decreasing, and if there's going to be fewer in-person transactions, we probably want them to take place now in our centres, not just because of our net zero aspirations, but also to help out the other existing businesses. Mm-hmm. I want one other angle to levelling the playing field, and it was in a report that FSB did a few years ago, was just when this Parliament considers new rules on business, it was going to be really important that it considers both traditional operators and online operators. And, you know, looking forward to our net zero ambitions, you know, when we consider, for example, new rules on waste, it will be both really important to consider how traditional shops will get on with those rules and online operators. And that's why we've suggested that consideration of the digital economy should be, form part of future BRIAs, or business regulatory impact assessments in future. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And just finally, Gillian talked about the example of Shoe, who are combining their retail with online sales. Because the committee is looking at town centres, we're interested in the places where people live and work and socialise. The move to online sale, does it affect the fabric of high streets? And what would be the way forward on this? Is it that kind of combined model that Gillian and our businesses moving towards that? Is there barriers to doing that? Is there reasons why? I think we heard from Dumfries, a big retailer who moved from having a physical shop, who then moved to a kind of locker, and there was advantages in having a locker type system. So how do we encourage businesses to think, remain on the high street and deliver two services from the same place?
I think it's probably going to be great if you're Shoe and you've got a spare floor upstairs, and the businesses that operate from smaller units will find that more tricky. There's also, anecdotally from our members, issues with things like access if you're getting a lot of deliveries or taking a lot of deliveries away from a high street premises. So easier for some businesses than others to run both an e-commerce business and a physical shop from the same premises, because they're, you know, designed for different purposes. Not impossible, but there are challenges along the way. What I would say is that if businesses are going to need different premises for running a combined e-commerce and shop type business, then we need Scotland's commercial property market to be adaptive to their needs. Now, one thing the UK government has done recently is launch a review into the legislative and regulatory framework which governs the landlord and tenant relationship. And we think that would be a useful thing for the Scottish government to do as well, because our view is that if you look up and down high streets across Scotland, there are many empty units, but the price of occupying those units don't seem to be falling. Mm-hmm. And that suggests to us that the property market isn't working as it should. And that, you know, that has a range of negative consequences. And broadly, it should be cheap to take up units on the high street, and it isn't. And we need to ask why that is at this time.
OK, thank you very much. I'd like to thank all four witnesses this morning for your contributions. I'll now briefly suspend while we change over the panel. Thank you. May I now welcome our second panel this morning. We're joined by Neil Francis, Managing Director, along with Siobhan McDermott, who's the Team Leader of Digital Trade Services, both from Scottish Development International, and they're joined by Hugh Lightbody, Chief Officer with Business Gateway. As before, if members and witnesses could keep their answers as short and concise as possible, and all three will get a chance to answer some questions. You might not be called for each question, but you will get a chance to speak this morning. If I could maybe start, in the previous panel, we heard that traditionally Business Gateway wouldn't offer support for retail. It's not a sector that's prioritised. During the pandemic, there was obviously more support coming through Scottish Government that went through local agencies, whether in terms of business rate support in particular for retail. As we're at the inquiry is looking at the change in nature of retail, would you see any future role for Business Gateway or local agencies given more support and having more engagement with the retail sector? Hugh, would you like to come in?
Well, happy to respond to that. In actual fact, the previous panel is incorrect in its response. Business Gateway actually does support retail sector. Something like 9% of the startups we supported last year were retail, and around 7% of Digital Boost clients last year were retail. So we actually do support the retail sector.
Has that been a recent increase, or was that? I think they did say traditionally there's been less of an engagement, or.
No, retail has always been a sector we've supported from the moment that the local authorities took on responsibility for the Business Gateway service in 2008.
And how have you, could you maybe reflect on how you've seen the retail sector changing? What kind of support Business Gateway have provided? And more, you did mention the Digital Boost project. So maybe what kind of support you provide in that area, but how the sector has changed and the type of support that you offer has changed?
I would say that our support hasn't changed. We're there, obviously, as a service. We inherited the service in 2008, just at the point of the financial crisis, and a significant proportion of our support at that point in time, and indeed ever since, has been about survival of businesses, irrespective of the sector. It's been very much about survival. Something like 40% of the businesses that we support indicate the main benefit is survival of the business. So since 2008, what we've been about really is as well as trying to support businesses to start up and establish businesses to grow, it's been very much about building resilience in those businesses, making them stronger, better businesses, trying to cope with the situations that we've had to face. Financial crisis being one, the pandemic being the most recent. And if you look at the ONS figures for 3-year survivability for startups, the ONS figures are 57%. A startup coming through Business Gateway, that's 77%. So you're about 1/3 more likely to survive 3 years if Business Gateway has helped you to start a business than if we haven't, because we're baking in resilience from the get-go.
And I know that obviously we're coming up to an election this week, so you might be some questions you're not as comfortable addressing, but do you find there's, you don't have to mention places, do you find there's variation across Scotland in terms of the support that Business Gateways are asked to provide to retail, or is it pretty much the same? Is it?
I would say it's consistent across the piece. The model of delivery varies from place to place, whether it's an in-house service or it's contracted, but the support is the same wherever you are. There's a consistency there.
So what I meant was, is the demand for the support the same, or is there areas in Scotland where it's stronger, or does it vary?
I don't have the detail on that, I'm afraid. I couldn't comment on that.
Okay, that's no problem. I'm going to hand over to Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much. Following on from that line of questioning from Claire, Hugh, can I ask, you said 7% of the support you offered last year through Digital Boost was to the retail sector. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and a little bit about some of the challenges that the retail sector maybe brought to you as you were supporting them through Digital Boost? I've got a couple of follow-ups, but if I can start with that, thanks.
Yeah, I mean, the kind of support that we're offering through the Digital Boost programme, and it's perhaps useful to draw a wee distinction here. Digital Boost is something that we have been delivering for 7 years now. And what that came out of was once upon a time, we had the Digital Scotland Business Excellence Partnership, which is a bit of a mouthful. And what the various agencies and FSB and others sitting around that table were trying to do was to look at the digital situation that Scotland had. One of the things that informed that, and you in fact touched on it earlier, was that DEBS work that was done. There was a digital maturity index that showed back then that Scotland wasn't particularly digitally mature and we needed to do something about it. The government's digital strategy at the time said that Scottish Enterprise, Highlands Islands Enterprise and the Business Gateway Service should work together to develop a programme of support, which was about increasing the capacity and the capability of Scottish SMEs to tackle the digital situation, to become more digitally savvy, basically. That's what the Digital Boost programme became. That's what it is. More recently, what the government's done through the Digital Boost grant is to use the brand to promote that grant. But the grant is something that's very much Scottish Government working with its contractor to deliver the grant. All we're doing is using the name to promote that, basically, because the brand is very well established. But the kind of support we're offering in the kind of area that we're looking at here in terms of retail or indeed any sector in terms of e-commerce is we have a webinar on online sales, improve, develop and make more money, it's called. We also have various coaching sessions that we offer, things like selling on Amazon, how to sell your products on eBay, selling on Etsy, and I know Gillian mentioned that earlier on, how to integrate your online shop with Instagram and Facebook, selling online, how to choose the right platform, because there are many different platforms, and selling your products on Shopify and WooCommerce. But those are backed up by various other webinars and coaching sessions on, for example, how to build a digital marketing plan, paid for advertising, email marketing for business, how to set up an email marketing campaign, and Google My Business, how to create a profile, and various others. So we're offering a wide range of support that is helping businesses, not just retail businesses, but any business, to become more digitally savvy and have the opportunity to trade online.
Thanks very much, Hugh. I mean, it's interesting, given what we heard in the panel, in the discussion earlier this morning, there seems almost to be a gap then between, you know, the huge range of support that you are providing and the support that is being sought by retail businesses, whether they are bricks based only or bricks and clicks based. I wonder, do you have, as part of Business Gateway, any plans to any future plans to reach out to retail and other sort of town centre businesses more explicitly, more directly to enable them to access the support that you provide? And are there areas, geographical areas, that you have identified as being areas where actually no support is sought at all that we should be aware of?
I think, and again, coming back to the DEBS piece of work that you touched on earlier, the key message that's emerging from that and the most recent DEBS survey is showing, whilst there's been, and what we're trying to do, we're trying to move businesses up the digital maturity curve. And what that survey is telling us is we haven't advanced very far. Businesses are still kind of reluctant. They're not picking up the opportunities necessarily. Mm. So that maturity is not as evolved or developed yet as we might have wanted it to be. There's still work to be done there. And I think in terms of what areas and what we want to look at, we have the new National Strategy for Economic Transformation. There's a lot of work to be done around the whole kind of concept and idea of regional economic partnerships. So I think there's a lot of that work still needs to be kind of thought through, developed, and the kind of action plans that emerge from that as to where are the priorities, what are we trying to do, again, with any sector, what are the actions that we need to take to try and transform the economy over the next 10 years. And clearly, retail, town centre regeneration, all of that needs to be built into that.
Thanks very much, Hugh. I'll leave it there.
Before I bring in Gordon, can I just maybe put a question to Neil and Siobhan? I'd asked initially about retail sector and Business Gateway. Could you maybe say a bit about Scottish Development Scotland? What engagement yourself or you are a branch of Scottish Enterprise, what support you provide to the retail sector in Scotland, if it is an area that you work with at all? Neil, do you want to come in?
I'll come in. Thank you, convener. Just help committee members. So Scottish Development International is the international division of Scottish Enterprise. We are part of Scottish Enterprise, but our focus is on that international dimension. So in terms of your question, convener, I think you know, it's important that we continue as Scottish Enterprise to focus strongly on our purpose to help businesses to innovate and scale to transform the economy. So we want to and are and continue to work with businesses who are ambitious and want to grow and help make the transformation to our economy that we would all like to see. And that is set out in the NSET that was launched a couple of months ago. In terms of retail sector, I think traditionally people have always been very nervous about the public sector intervening to support that sector. And I think it's been a bit of a blunt instrument and is used as shorthand, if I like. So, the important thing is to ensure that public resources don't go in to support one business to compete against another local business. So traditionally, one could argue that if one retailer was being supported, then it would be to the disadvantage of another local retailer. So the issue is really understanding how you intervene in any sector to help that contribute to overall growth and not simply displace economic activity from one local business to another. But of course, what we do know is retail, as we've already heard today, is changing and is no longer what it used to be.
Scottish Enterprise have previously supported Amazon, and we have the development in my region, and Dunfermline's had support before, which is retail. And I suppose the argument about we can't support one retailer, it might have an impact on another, would that not hold for other sectors as well, for any business that was in a competitive field?
It does, and that's, I guess, what it was not very clearly explaining, that it's considering what impact that particular business has and whether it's in a market that is growing and expanding rather than simply displacing an existing business. Traditionally, then, people have used retail as a way of saying, well, in retail, there's a lot of local businesses that would be actually competing against each other. Your example about Amazon is, demonstrating that you've got to be careful by just putting everything together into one sector, because it's really about what that business is trying to achieve, what market it's in, and how best you can support that particular business.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to let Colin Smith in on this question, and then I'll bring Gordon MacDonald in.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I just follow up that point with Mr. Francis? I mean, what you effectively be saying is that the role of Scottish Enterprise in our town centres, simply because of displacement, and your focus is entirely on economic growth rather than, for example, inclusive growth, means that there isn't that support there for retail in our town centres. One of the messages that we're getting is that our town centres need to change, for example, more cultural facilities, those types of areas. But are you really saying that because of the remit of Scottish Enterprise, which may, for example, differ from Highlands and Islands Enterprise and the South of Scotland Enterprise, which has that social element, that you don't really see there being a role in supporting our high streets from Scottish Enterprise because of that remit you have?
So it's a great question. So I think there's two separate bits to that. I mean, what we are all, I think, clearly in agreement about is that our town centres across Scotland are really important in terms of the economic fabric across the regions. And what we do know is that, I guess, the pandemic has accelerated the change that was already happening. So finding a productive future for our town centres, a role they can play both in the economy and to our communities, is really important. So I think that is something that needs to be done. In terms of then our role, I think it's also important that we are clear on our focus and purpose, and that we are continuing to deliver that focus, as I said, on those businesses that can innovate, those businesses that can scale, and those businesses that can help transform our economy.
McDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. And a lot of the questions I was going to ask has actually been touched upon. So the one thing I'm still looking for some clarification on is, we've talked a lot about digital boost this morning and the grants of up to 50% that Business Gateway has helped. And I read the evidence from the British Independent Retailers Association, who said that there was a requirement for more coordinated collection of the support available, both private and public, in order that could be aimed to small micro businesses to get them to get an e-commerce platform. So I was wondering, Hugh, if you could highlight, either through the Scottish Funding Portal, what funding is available to the retail sector in order to take up the opportunity of having an online business?
I don't have any information on what funding's are actually available. Business Gateway as a service generally doesn't do funding. We don't have grants or anything that we offer. The Digital Boost grant, as I said earlier, was a Scottish Government initiative run by Scottish Government through their contractor. As a service, as I say, Business Gateway, we can signpost people to funding, and we do signpost people to funding, but it's not something that we deliver directly ourselves.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mira. I think you possibly heard the previous witnesses where we were discussing about collaboration in terms of developing digital services. And there seemed to be a bit of a, I wouldn't say a disagreement, but different view on whether there was such training in any adequate form, or whether it was, my words, a bit disjointed and sparse. So is there a role for Scotland's universities and colleges in boosting developing digital services with Scotland's retail businesses, and what role would the enterprise agencies play in that, given that you are already carrying out training functions? And I'm thinking here particularly, again, referring back to the comments of the previous witnesses, where they didn't seem to be recognising much of what you were doing. I'll ask maybe Hugh.
Okay, thanks. I think that's obviously very much a question for Skills Development Scotland, who are doing a lot of work in the kind of digital skills side, and who have strong links with Scottish Funding Council and through them to the various universities and colleges out there. But as I say, that's more a question for them in terms of what they're doing. But what we are doing collectively and collaboratively with Skills Development Scotland and with the other enterprise agencies on the back of the Enterprise and Skills review, the last one we had, we have created something called the Business Support Partnership, and the enterprise agencies, ourselves, local government, and Skills Development Scotland, Creative Scotland, Visit Scotland, we're all working together to tackle one of the kind of key findings that came out of the Enterprise and Skills Review was the clutter and confusion in the marketplace. So what we're trying to do there is collaborate, align, work together to be sure that what is being delivered is what the marketplace is looking for, and decide who's best placed to then deliver that, so that we don't have duplication of services, we don't have duplication of what's going on. Within that, there is the opportunity, and we are in discussion with colleagues across the enterprise agencies on the digital side of things. What are the kind of things we need to be doing? Who's best to deliver them? And there are different things there. I mean, Business Gateway tends to be the service that's there for the volume market, for the micro enterprises, for the small businesses. And our colleagues in the enterprise agencies are picking up those businesses, as kind of Neil has touched on, where there is perhaps the greater opportunity and the need for greater investment to actually realise those opportunities. So it's that pipeline of support that we're collaboratively and collectively working our way through. And I think just to pick up on what Neil was saying earlier there, that I think what he was saying was it depends on the circumstances sometimes. And I know prior to South of Scotland Enterprise, when that region, Borders, was covered by Scottish Enterprise as well, we had a local, very traditional, ladies and gents, outfitters, a retail business, where we argued successfully for additional support from Scottish Enterprise for the very reason that there was a growth opportunity. The displacement wasn't there in that instance. It was supporting local supply chain providers of products, and they were internationalising. So where the circumstances allow, there is support there for particular retail businesses.
Neil, perhaps since the finger's been pointed at you, you might like to come in and comment on that. I mean, are we disjointed in our approach to developing digital services?
So it's a great question, and I would just support what Hugh has said. I think through Find Business Support, we've done a lot around ensuring it's easy, it's comprehensive for customers to find out the support and services available in the digital arena, but across all the services provided to support businesses. Can we do more to make it even easier and better joined up? Then the answer to that is definitely. There's always room for improvement. It's been a long-standing, I think, piece of feedback businesses have provided us collectively over many, many years about getting that joined upness as best as possible. What I would say, in addition to your question around the role universities and colleges can play, I think, you know, we know as a country that we need to improve digital skills in so many areas, and the universities and colleges and schools have a critical role to embed that in all that they deliver. So all our young people, as they move through the education system, are building foundational digital skills to a much higher level than we currently have. So I think they do have a critical pathway. I do also think that when it comes to specific technical or e-commerce or commercial digital skills, then there is a role to be played by the private sector in delivering those into the marketplace, and also by the agencies. They are, I think, slightly different in their focus and what they're trying to achieve than can be the type of skills that the universities and colleges can do for everyone.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Michelle Thompson. Would you like to come in?
Just picking up on some of the kind of general themes, you'll appreciate that this inquiry is very, very wide-ranging, and I know you listened to the earlier panel. One of the challenges we have is to produce recommendations that add real resonance and meaning. So based on the earlier session, which I know you listened to, and today's session, are there, say, two top areas that you could pick out that we could recommend to be done? I know it's rather generic, but this is so wide-ranging, trying to pull it together. So I just appreciate your thoughts. A couple off the top of your head, if there was one or two things that we would do, what would they be? I'd actually like everyone to answer that. Neil, you're smiling, so I'll come to you first.
Thank you. It's the first time I've been asked such a question, what would be on top of my list. So it's great to have that opportunity. I think, you know, part of the reason we are here in terms of Scottish Development International is because of that international dimension. And I think what we see is the continuation of internationalizing our economy is probably even more important today than it's ever been. And I think, you know, what we've seen with the pandemic, Brexit, geopolitical, energy security, and everything else, that the international landscape is so complex, it's so fast moving. But ultimately, what happens out there has an impact for us. And the way we navigate that landscape going forward will be incredibly important for our future economic prosperity and well-being. So top of my list is, how do we support even more of our growth businesses to internationalize and use e-commerce as a mechanism of being able to penetrate new markets further afield?
Thank you. Who would like to go next? Siobhan, you've appeared next. Oh, Hugh.
I'll jump in. We did an impact analysis of the various programmes which reported last summer, and I would turn to the recommendations that have emerged from that in terms of what I personally would like to see, and some of these things I think have been kind of touched on earlier in your earlier session. The first thing was strengthen coordination and strategic guidance forum. I talked earlier about the Digital Scotland Business Excellence Partnership, bit of a mouthful, DISBEP. That has disappeared. I think it would be valuable to bring something of that nature back together again, because that's quite a few years ago now since we did that. We're getting back, eight, ten years now even since that happened. So let's sit around the table again, get all the players back around that table, talk about DISBEP again. This was touched on earlier. There is a need to raise awareness of the benefits of investing in digital technologies and services and of support available. We are raising awareness through the Business Gateway website, through the social media work that we do. We have various very good case studies. We find case studies very useful in promoting things. Findra was talked about earlier, one of ours. So case studies are important, but raising awareness generally of the benefit of investing in digital, what the return on investment is, and so on. There's a continued need for digital support programme funding. A 3 or 5 year funding cycle would be more helpful in that regard than annual funding rounds. Expanding offer to meet need. The demand is there, but one of the challenges, certainly more widely within Business Gateway, is that the money hasn't increased in the 14 years that local government has had the service. So we're about 40% below where we ought to be if we were keeping up with what's needed. So that's a kind of key one. What else have we got in there? There is a need to focus more resources on encouraging businesses to progress from what we call, can be called entry-level digital technologies and services to more advanced systems. That's what I talked about earlier, that digital maturity curve. We have to remember that we have a business base out there that isn't necessarily doing the things that we might want them to do. They might not have the ambition to do. They might be quite happy where they are. So we need to encourage them to think about taking on more opportunity. Is recommended that great investment is made up made in an upfront audit and advice package. That's why we have the digital health check under Digital Boost. Get businesses to have a think about what do they need. That, again, is why within the last round of the Digital Boost grant, the government introduced a digital implementation plan to get the businesses to think about what they were going to do with the resource. Also recommended the great investment is made in aftercare, modify future grant distribution process, and invest in internal systems.
Yeah, you've given us so many, and all you're doing is prompting further questions in me, which I'm going to resist asking. Siobhan, I wanted to, because I'm aware of the other people who want to come in. Siobhan, you're top two, if you can limit it to that.
I think you did very well to rhyme off a massive list there. I think I would probably go more to the practical, actually. Looking at the previous session, we had Wes talking about agency engagement and curating the communities. I would like to see more of that. We would be very happy to work with Wes again. If they've got a pipeline of companies who are keen to learn more, we have our international e-commerce programme. We could create specific cohorts for those communities. So I would like to see more of that. Also, in addition, we previously had e-commerce clubs. We ran quite a number of these in Glasgow and Edinburgh in 2018-2019. COVID pandemic saw that short shrift, obviously. We would like to reignite those e-commerce clubs, because that's where you have those practitioners and people leading in e-commerce and leading in business actually talking about the benefits of it, sharing their stories and also, you know, their war wounds. And how they've actually recovered from some of those issues. So I would like to see more of that. And if I can make on just one last other point, I would like to see more priority made within businesses around designating e-commerce roles within their organisations, because many of the companies that we have worked with, we are seeing e-commerce as an add-on to the marketing team, or even to, you know, business development, or even sometimes to the finance specialist, where they're also being tasked with looking at e-commerce for their business. And I think, you know, it goes back to the whole point around skills development. Yes, absolutely, we need to be doing more around that. But then it's also supporting the business and raising the awareness of the importance of having those designated roles to actually drive that part of the business forward.
Thank you very much, Camina. Thank
going
you,
to bring in Colin Smith, to be followed by Alexander.
Thanks very much, Convener. I suppose my question is really around the team from SDI. It's really to ask what sectors and areas offer the best international opportunities when it comes to Scottish retailers, and how can the support you provide directly benefit our high streets, ensuring that some of those retailers are not in out-of-town developments, for example, but they're actually businesses that are based in our town centres?
Do you want to ask Michelle or Neil?
I don't mind Siobhan or Neil. We'll go with Siobhan just to help the cameras. I think that'll make it easier if I did that. Yeah.
Well, certainly, if we're looking at e-commerce in the round, you know, how we would speak to a business who has approached us, you know, in the retail sector with an inquiry about e-commerce, you know, we would look at their you know, a business needs a digital footprint, for example, they would need a Google knowledge panel, you know, that the panel on the right-hand side of their Google search results when you search for a particular business. We would recommend that they have financial solutions in place to help with VAT and tax returns. We would also ensure that they were using free software, like FreeAgent, for example. We would also, you know, very much be dealing with them as we would any other company, and we would be looking at the, you know, the benefits of e-commerce, but we would be looking for them to develop a more robust digital marketing and an e-commerce strategy, including development of an e-commerce website with the associated software tools to manage customers' orders and finance. There are examples out there of businesses, you know, who are in the retail sector, who are applying, you know, the good practice of e-commerce in their businesses today. So yeah, you know, we would encourage them to overlay that good practice in the high street too.
Is there a gap there at the moment? I mean, retailers have been so used to the footfall being effectively people walking up the high street that they're maybe not aware of these opportunities. I mean, do you detect there's a gap there and there's an untapped resource, if you like, of businesses on our high streets that could benefit more from that digital reach?
I think, you know, Gillian touched on it earlier on, you know, most retail sales take place on the high street. She talked about bricks and clicks and e-commerce versus the high street, which I think, you know, we shouldn't even go down that road at all. I think, you know, digital is such a fast moving area, and it is, you know, front of mind for all of us, particularly since the COVID pandemic recently. And businesses who are, you know, staying ahead of the curve are those that are actually adopting new digital technologies, adapting their business models. And that's something that we would very much be encouraging, you know, businesses to do, you know, through our international e-commerce programs. But really, as far as retail goes, we would be certainly signposting those businesses to Business Gateway in the first instance as well for that support, because they are, you know, Hugh talks about, you know, the wealth of support and the fundamental skills that are being delivered through Business Gateway. And all of these things, you know, digital marketing, understanding social media, all of this can be adapted for the retail and the high street, but then they just have to tap into those tools and support that are freely available.
Just bringing in Neil now, is it realistic to think that we will have a team of businesses on our high streets reaching out to international markets from the back of the shop, if you like, to make up for the fact that they're not getting as many people coming in the front door of that shop?
Well, I think Stuart in the previous panel and Gillian gave examples of where that can work and where it might not work because of access issues and space and what have you. I think that the starting point for this, as for all businesses, is understanding what the business's overall growth strategy is. I think it's really important that, you know, businesses take the time to think clearly about their future strategy rather than simply jumping on what might seem an easy solution. And I think what Siobhan has highlighted is it's actually quite complex and it's fast moving, and it requires both capability, commitment, and some level of investment. I think from an international perspective, it's that difference. You're on one hand, you can say you're potentially accessing billions of customers, but as in the high street, there might be, you know, billions of people walking past your virtual shop and no one's stopping in. So I think there needs to be some time taken to support the businesses to think through their international strategy, which markets do they have products that would work best for? Are there issues around product localization, i.e. do you have to change your products in any shape or form to comply with both what's demanded in that market, and also with the regulations and legislative kind of frameworks within that market. Are you going to look at platforms that are horizontal, or are you going to look for platforms that are vertical, so in the niche for the thing you're selling? Selection of which platform is incredibly important. They all have different kind of features, different cost structures related to them. So, you know, the opportunity to grow your business through international e-commerce is significant and available, but it does need planning and good execution to realize it. Now, your second bit of how that would affect what happens on the high street, I think, depends on who's doing it and whether the business growth strategy is one of both bricks and mortar and the e-commerce or something else.
Thank you. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, convener. Just as with the previous panel question about digital sales tax, it has been previously discussed at other sessions of what that might look like if it was introduced, and maybe level up the playing field between online and bricks and mortar sales. I just wonder what the panel's view is on that, and maybe starting with Neil, you know, given your international remit, you know, what you see happening elsewhere and what issues you see might arising.
So I'm not overly familiar with the detail of what's being proposed in the digital sales tax. I listened very carefully to the comments that Stuart was making, and seemed very, very, very sensible indeed. I think the principle of creating level playing fields is a really good one, but as we all know, the detail, the devil is always in the detail and how it is kind of framed, whether it has the desired policy outcomes or whether there are unintended consequences. I think internationally, it's completely different everywhere in terms of the approaches. I think one of the relevant things is that when you are selling and shipping goods to other markets, then, you know, there are lots of issues around taxation and so on and so forth that you need to be aware of in terms of your approach to the customs requirements for each market that you might be targeting. I think that's sometimes for small businesses that they might not fully understand, thinking you can just run up to the post office and ship it off and that's the end of it. But you know, we've seen through the changes in approach when we've exited the European Union, there are some quite significant issues that businesses need to pay attention to when they are shipping goods from the UK to other markets overseas.
Thank you. And Hugh, is there anything you'd like to add?
I think I would agree with Neil in terms of his comments on what Stuart had said. I think Stuart made it very clear that we have to think very carefully about it in terms of scale, because there's a wheen of difference between wanting to tax Amazon with billions of turnover and a small retail business where it might just be in the thousands, because who can afford it? Let's not cripple the wee business before we even established their ability to do what they want to do. I think was where he was kind of coming from, and I think I would agree with that.
Yeah, thank you. And Siobhan?
I think Neil and Hugh have said it all, really. I've nothing really much further to add to that. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And no further questions, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just now put a final question to Neil? There's a couple of things. In Siobhan's description of what SDI do you do proactive work as well? Do you promote the idea of online sales as well as support? Because I think it's described as when a business comes to you, this is what we do. Do you promote what you're able to do? Another question was, you talked about exiting the EU and the changes. When we were down in Dumfries, we did visit one of the shops who had a specialist shop. They do online sales as well, and they were telling me how they sell a lot down south, down to London. But they said their European sales have really dropped since we left the EU. There's obviously different taxation, different selling online than what it was prior to that. Is that a common experience, and how do we rebuild confidence in those areas?
So, great question. I'll deal with the first. So, yes, we do promote the opportunities to grow your business internationally that e-commerce allows. So we are being as proactive as possible. I think, you know, a lot of today's conversation has been essentially, I think, around business to consumer, i.e. retail. But I think it would be important not to overlook the opportunity in terms of international growth for business-to-business e-commerce. And we're seeing a lot of that and are supporting and promoting that activity too. I think, as I said earlier on, for us, it's all about helping businesses that have the ambition to grow their business internationally, about selecting the right international growth strategy and also the right markets to target, and then see how e-commerce plays a role in delivering that overall ambition. In terms of your comment about the EU, yes, I would say that is not an isolated piece of feedback that you dated from Dumfries. I think it can be very difficult now for small companies to sell into the former kind of or the kind of European Union countries. There's a lack of consistency across the countries, so it's not as if we've got one new set of relationships with the EU. We tend to have different interpretations of how the new framework works country to country, which makes it even harder for small companies to navigate.
And are you undertaking work to support businesses in understanding the new environment to trade in?
We are. We've done a huge amount of work in helping them do that, and we'll continue to do that. But ultimately, it is more complex than it used to be. You know, we can support businesses, but you know, it's not in our gift to take away the complexity. And just, you know, extending that point a little bit, as I said earlier, I mean, you know, across the globe now, I mean, you know, the UK is entering into new free trade agreements. There are international trade and alliances or blocks emerging in all parts of the countries. So it's becoming a much more complex landscape for businesses to continue to trade in. So continuing to help them and support them will be an important role going forward, I think.
Okay, thank you very much to the witnesses this morning. That brings us to the end of the evidence session. It concludes the public part of the meeting, and we'll now move into private session.